Brothers and sisters, I need your attention. As I speak in the spiritual essence of the Most High vibrates through my soul, I know that we see the oppression and that we have to find our opposition and giving it a color. Brother, you may call it the man. Sister, you may call it the system. Whatever it is, we all agree it's white. But be clear, when we make the opposition anything outside of ourselves, we begin to miss me, the spirit. I am is you, and I lives in every vessel walking this earth as the word in action.
Peace, family. I am glad to announce that this is our first episode of our web series entitled The Poetry Corner here on L.E.A.D TV. I am Jabe, and this season will be a great one. Family, we have some great poets that are here to showcase their talents and delve into a deep conversation about their poetry. The poets that we are going to feature this season are very socially aware, and we can tell that they are tuned in to what is taking place within our culture, and they use the power of words to convey our experiences. Here is a video from our first Poetry Corner participant.
It's kind of chaotic right now. Miss Kelita here, she's about to come up.
Newsflash! As I look at my people, I become immensely depressed. Because no matter the strides we make, we continue to be oppressed. By force, by choice, a lot of both it seems. Our minds have been desolated, but our eyes still gleam. A manifestation of our hearts, beat up and torn, but still there. Words puncture through and sting us with hurt and despair. A crippling, repetitious mechanism is still in full effect. To eradicate this issue, we must take each piece and carefully dissect. We will find a lot of things broken, bruised, torn, and scarred from all of the lies and mistreatment from a past that's not so far. To rebuild our nation, we have to arise from a deep sleep. We have to ditch all of the programming that has transformed us into sheep. Because our enemy is still lurking like a confounding variable in math. It doesn't take a rocket scientist to realize what will happen if we continue down this path. They say that history repeats itself. Well, I, for one, am not with it. I was born to make a change, and I'm fearless and committed. I am just one person. But one person is all that it takes. And I'm willing to risk it all because I realize what's at stake. Patience is a virtue. Time is of the essence. Love is everlasting, and energy is always present. Knowledge is power. How you use it is key. Money isn't everything. The best things in life are free. If my words fall upon deaf ears, my actions will still be seen because I embody everything that I say. I am the epitome of a queen. I will protect my people and uplift them at every given chance. I am a self-appointed leader, and this is your newsflash.
So without any further ado, I would like to introduce our first poet. She is a published author. Her book entitled Poetic Transitions, Evidence of Growth is available online through Barnes & Noble and Amazon. She has another poetry book on the way and has performed her poetry in front of many of our fellow Atlanteans. Let's welcome a queen, a mother, our sister, Kelita A., the poetry teller. How you doing?
I'm good. How
you doing all right?
Mm-hmm.
Good. Glad for you to be here with us on this Sunday. It's a beautiful day outside.
It is. Thank you for having me.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. We're glad you're able to make it. We're going to go right into a discussion about the poem that everyone just was able to see.
Okay.
So tell us, you know, where you were when you performed this and what was like the reaction of the crowd.
Well, I was at a barbershop, and it was for a barbershop cipher. And so they actually had me and one other spoken word artist to perform before they allowed the rappers to go on. So it consisted of a lot of females. The people who put it together were females, so they made sure to get a lot of females involved. And basically the reaction was kind of like, okay, like that's different.
You had them thinking. You had them thinking. That's what I'm talking about. So what was the inspiration behind that poem that you performed, and what was the title of it, actually?
The title of the poem was Newsflash. I would say the inspiration behind it was kind of like to do like a play on how the news is now and how social media, we use it as our news. Mm-hmm. So I was like, okay, well, you want a real news flash? Like, here you go. Like, you know, this is what's going on. Like, take the glasses off, take the shades off, and like see what's really going on. Like, you have all this stuff that has happened to our people. This is where we are now. How do we get out of this state?
Right.
It's not going to be by continuing to doing the same things we've been doing. Mm-hmm. Something's got to change.
That's wonderful. Compared to the other content that you heard that night from the poets as well as the rappers, was anything on par with the content that was in your poem?
Yes, I would say like a lot of people mentioned the things that are plaguing Black people, I guess you would say, like injustices in our community.
Okay. So everybody was really feeling it, voicing their opinions, very expressive night.
Right.
That's good. So we have more coming up with Kelita A, the poetry teller. Remember, you're watching The Poetry Corner on L.E.A.D TV. We'll be back after these messages.
To Atlanta where the players play, and we ride on them things like every day. Big beats hit streets, see gangsters roaming, and parties don't stop till 8 in the morning.
Welcome to Atlanta where the players play, and we ride on them things like every day. Big beats hit streets, see gangsters roaming, and parties don't stop till 8 in the morning.
Yo. Welcome to Atlanta where the players play, and we ride on them things like every day. Big beats hit streets, see gangsters roaming, and parties don't stop till 8 in the morning.
Welcome to
Atlanta. Welcome to Name This Poet. Whose first book of poetry was published in 1926 and was entitled The Weary Blues? Was it A. Maya Angelou, B. Langston Hughes, or C. Paul Laurence Dunbar? The answer is B. Langston Hughes. Langston Hughes was 24 years old when his debut poetry collection, The Weary Blues, was published in 1926. The book won several awards, and the prize money allowed Hughes to complete his college education. Stay tuned for more of Name This Poet. Welcome back to The Poetry Corner. I'm here with Kelita A, the poetry teller, and we want to let everyone know that you can be on social media right now. Make sure that you use the hashtag, The Poetry Corner, and start sending us some of your views, some of your thoughts of what you're thinking about this episode and any future episode that takes place. We'd like to see your thoughts, and we'd like to communicate back and forth with you and create an interaction between you and those at home. Now, we're going to go into the background a little bit of your upbringing, how your upbringing played a part in you being able to create your poetry. So we will tell everybody, you know, how you began and what age you began writing poetry.
So I actually started writing poetry when I was in the fifth grade by accident. We had a writing assignment, and I realized after I finished that it rhymed, and I was impressed by that. So I decided to actually start writing poetry from that experience. So I was like, okay, like I wrote a poem. Let me actually try to write one now.
Right.
And so it was through that that I began developing my talents more and more.
Okay, that makes sense. And for me, just to fill you in on my background, it wasn't fifth grade, it was sixth grade for me. About sixth grade, we had to do an assignment, we had to write a poem, and for some reason, I got real excited when the teacher said, and I started writing it. I don't know if it rhymed or not, but I just remember being excited that we had to do it. And then from there, I have been writing ever since that point, so I can relate to you on that. So were any of your parents or relatives influential in your poetic journey?
Yes, like actually both of my grandmothers wrote poetry. My mom's mom, she used to write our Easter speeches like every year.
Mm-hmm.
And my dad's mom, she's actually like written and performed her poetry.
Okay.
So she's actually working on her very own poetry book now.
Really, you inspired her?
Yeah.
Wow. So that's another link that we have, because I helped my granddad do a poetry book. He did the poetry book, and I helped compose the music, because he did like 10 poems over some music. Okay. And then he had released that. I think he did that in like 2014. So it's the same thing. He just said, hey, I know you do poetry, and the spirit just hit me and just had me start writing it. So I figured I should compose a book, and he published the book. Yeah, that's crazy, man. That's crazy. So, how has being from Atlanta and growing up in such a unique cultural environment influenced you and your poetry?
Well, Atlanta's so diverse, I would say, especially because we have like so many people moving here. And I went to a Georgia State University for school, so they're like one of the top schools for diversity. Mm-hmm. So, being here in Atlanta, for me, it helped me to basically look at the problems that are facing us, not only as Black people, but as humans. Mm-hmm. So a lot of my poems hold like a variety of things. It's not just about Black people, but it might be about love. It might be about women. It might be, you know, just different perspectives on things.
Right. Okay. Now, you wrote a book.
I did.
So tell people about your first publication.
Okay, well, my book, like you said, is called Poetic Transitions, Evidence of Growth. And basically, I titled it that because I started writing it when I was in the fifth grade, basically from the poems that I was telling you I started writing. And I just saved as many as I could throughout the years. By the time I got to high school, I wanted to publish it, but I was feeling as though it was not complete. And that's just part of me being a perfectionist. And just wanting to keep, you know, making it perfect. And I had to realize, you know, there's no perfect. So you just got to do it whenever you feel the time is right. So that's what I ended up doing. I released the book based on the poems I wrote from fifth grade up until I graduated high school.
Okay. I've purchased this book. I've read the book. I read it all in one night. I seen the reviews on Amazon, and I seen people saying the same thing. So you all, make sure you go get the book. We'll provide that information for you again, but make sure you go get that. It's a great poetry book.
Thank you.
Now, we know you working on another one.
I am.
So fill the people in on that. Give them a little sneak peek on what's going into the inspiration behind that book.
Okay. So this one basically just gets deeper, and I guess you kind of, you know, we age from children into adults. So a lot of the meat of my first book was kind of through that childhood mind. Mm-hmm. So the second book, Poetic Transitions, Knowledge of Self, this one is basically, I guess, helping my readers to understand how either to obtain knowledge of self or how I did it.
Okay.
And I did this through basically life experiences. Mm-hmm. And that's what my poems are about. They're about a lot of my life experiences. But then again, a lot of them are about experiences of other people who I've encountered or just from my imagination.
Okay. We will hear a new poem from Kelita A, the poetry teller's upcoming book entitled Poetic Transitions, Knowledge of Self, after these messages.
I'm human. I'm a creator. I'm a mother. I'm beautiful. I could be you, but I have epilepsy. Do you look at me different now? Epilepsy lives matter.
Hi, my name is Asia. I'm at Atlanta MUA, and I'm the owner of the Glam Gal Makeup. Here's a sneak peek.
Tankless version today.
Good intentions, bad decisions. You see,
Her goal in life wasn't to become a baby mama. She always had good intentions. Didn't intend to have to get caught up in child support drama. She loved love and had dreams of getting married. She didn't know that the weight of the world would be placed on her shoulders to be carried, because she had always seen many images of a man with that task. So physically, she was a woman, but mentally, she wore a mask, determined to be the protector, the provider, and the nurturer. What the mask covered up was that this was really hurting her. She didn't want to play both roles. She had barely mastered one. She wasn't ready to be an adult. She was just starting to have fun. But she loved love. And he told her that he loved her. And to her, this meant that making love must occur. Together against the world, calling him her man, but content with being his girl. No symbolic token of his words was ever bought. He turned her dreams of marriage into a doubtful thought. How could he say things to her that he didn't really mean? How would she explain to her parents why she was pregnant at 16? No job, still in school, with a baby on the way. No proposal, no I do's, no spring wedding set in May. What happened to her vision? It used to be so clear. Perhaps it has been blurred from crying all of those tears. She considered an abortion or adoption to try to erase the pain, but what she didn't realize was that it was more than just a physical dilemma. It would also leave a mental stain. She no longer loved love. She despised it with all her might. She scoffed at the end of fairy tales and said to herself, "Yeah, right." She pushed her goals and dreams to the side to make room for a new life. Another unwed mother striving to cope with strife. Good intentions, bad decisions.
What a thought-provoking poem, family. We want to thank our sister for her words and thoughts on an experience that many of us can relate to, whether we know a relative or a friend who has gone through this experience, or those that may have experienced this reality personally. Kelita. Good intentions, bad decisions. Do you think women tend to, today, to, you know, fall for the wrong love?
I don't think they tend to fall for the wrong love, because I think love is a constant. Mm-hmm. But I think they may tend to fall for the wrong person.
The wrong person. Mm-hmm. Okay. Now give the difference between falling for the wrong person or falling for the wrong love. Can anybody ever fall for the wrong love?
I don't think anybody can ever fall for the wrong love. Basically, I guess love is kind of, it's a set in stone type of thing, but people kind of interpret it and display it the way that they feel, you know? So basically the way it should be, it's kind of similar to like the Bible verse, I think it's like Corinthians or something, when it's like love is patient, love is kind, like, you know, just giving you all those different characteristics of it. That's love. So anything that's outside of that isn't love. Right. So therefore, to fall for the wrong love, I don't feel people can do, but you can fall for the wrong person, because you can have a person who's giving you love, but they're only giving it to you from a half empty cup, or, you know. Like that.
Now, do you think that society has taught young adults the wrong perception of love?
I do think society has done that, more so through the media, like through movies and TV shows and stuff like that, because you generally in all movies you have some type of relationship, which is the foundation of the movie, and a lot of the times they're just over sexualized. So that's kind of what I'm talking about in this poem, how you can kind of fall for the idea of sex, maybe thinking that it's associated with love when they're two totally different things.
Okay, I can feel that. So how does that translate into especially in our community, the high amount of teen pregnancies that take place?
Well, I think that goes back to taking sex education out of schools. I'm not really sure why they did that, but I think that's something that's actually needed on a scientific level as well as on an emotional and mental level. So basically, if you're not learning about sex in school and you're not learning about love from home, or, you know, the places you should, and you're looking elsewhere to find out what these definitions are, then you ended up, you know, just basically trying to love as best you can by the definition that you were taught or that you found out through your experiences. And a lot of those times, those experiences might not be good.
Right. So you talked about that they need to know about it on, you know, a scientific level. But at the same time, love as well as sex has a spiritual side to it. So where should a, you know, someone in their adolescence or even an adult that just has had just a rough time with love and sex in general, where do they get the spiritual understanding of it from, you think?
The spiritual aspect of it is way deeper. And a lot of people basically have to search within in order to come to terms with what a spiritual connection, definition, anything like that actually is. And so that's also something I feel that it has to be taught, but it's also something that has to be felt and learned.
Right.
So basically, you have the scientific level, which I would say, like, basically, what is sex? Is this and this happening to create this and that? You know, that aspect.
Without trying to say the birds and the bees.
Right.
But get straight to the point on, you know, this is really the reality
exactly.
of it.
Exactly. Then the mental or emotional aspect of it. You know, by you doing this, what is this creating? You know, because physically your body is going to experience something when right. that happens. And then when you say the spiritual level, I feel like that's the deepest level. It's the most intimate and most important level of it.
Mm-hmm.
And I can't really say it's something that one person can describe because I feel like we're all different spirits, therefore mm-hmm. those type of interactions will always be different amongst us.
Right.
So
okay.
I feel like the spiritual connection is way deeper. It's like a different topic, different level for
right.
us.
Right. Right. And it can only really be experienced,
there
right?
You go.
Yeah, I can see that. So I got a question for you. So how will, like, how could parents play into this? Like, I was having a conversation with my dad about this, and you know, we were talking about how it's hard not to hide your children from seeing homosexuality on TV.
Extremely hard.
Extremely hard. There is like commercials and everything. They're like running it. So he asked me when I was younger, you know, because I used to say like homophobic stuff. So what would you do if your son, you had a son and then he was gay? I was like, I beat the hell out of him. Just straight up, I'm whooping his ass if he go in that route. So he like, but you can't react like that. You can't do that. And so I asked him, I said, so what about today's society? That's, you know, early 2000s, we had this conversation.
Mm-hmm.
That stuff wasn't on TV like
right.
that then.
Right.
So what you think now? And he, I don't know. He said, you know what? Both parents got to be in the home. He said it straight. You're going to have to hug on your wife, hug on your husband, kiss them in front of your children. He said growing up, when he was growing up, you know, they'd keep that away from the children, not show the children this type of stuff. But he was like, no, you're going to have to, like, display that because usually they're going to do what's in their home. So, again, your TV is in your home, so homosexuality is in your home. Whether you believe in homosexuality or not, it's going to be in your home. So when he broke that down to me, I said, that makes sense. Hug on your wife. Grab a butt in front of the children. He said, let them know that you love and you're infatuated with your significant other, basically, so they can see how, on a physical level,
mm-hmm.
it's expressed. And I guess you can pick up on emotional cues and things then. How you feel about that?
I think that's on point. Yeah, I actually don't even let my kids watch TV at home. Like, we don't even have cable. Like,
right,
no TV.
Yeah.
Like, I show them, like, old movies and stuff like
okay.
that because of that reason. Like, because of how TV is now.
You get into streaming or just internet?
On my laptop, on my phone,
mm-hmm.
but on TV, no, because I want them to look at a TV, recognize it as a TV and say, okay, you know, this is just for that type
right.
of stuff, entertainment.
Right.
I don't want them growing up thinking like this is
That's
real.
Reality.
Right, right.
right. Is that even to the point of saying that they should look at news the same way? I get people saying all the time, you need to watch the news. You need
My dad.
To know what's going you need to know what's going on.
My dad.
But if you really know the truth about it, and I went to school for it, man, this is stage, man. It looked like the truth, but it's colorable.
I said, I ain't got to watch the news to know somebody got shot, somebody
right.
stole something, somebody, you know, that's
yeah.
all they plague us with. And it's like, that's not news. Like,
right.
the stuff that's really news, that's really eye-catching, you know, they're not putting that out there. We're
right.
doing that. We're publicizing and sharing that on our social media
right.
and stuff like that, trying to get this out there as news.
Right.
So, yeah, I feel like news is whatever's new to you. Mm-hmm. If it's new information, that's news.
Right. So this is a wonderful conversation that we're having with you. Again, make sure that you participate in the hashtags on any form of social media, Twitter, Instagram, Facebook. Want you to hashtag the Poetry Corner. Let us know what you're feeling. Let us know your thoughts about love. Just let us know how you feel in the poem that was presented today. And just keep us posted on, you know, how you feel, and we'll interact with you all as well. So again, this is the Poetry Corner. We'll be back after these messages.
Hi, I'm Dr. Bates of Journey Family Chiropractic. Here at our office, we use a whole self approach to your care. What that means is we use chiropractic care, nutrition, and exercise. With this, it creates a healthy body, spirit, and mind. Here at Journey Family Chiropractic, our goal is to help you accomplish a quality state of health. At Journey Family Chiropractic, I see a range of different people, but I specialize in the care of women and children. As a woman and a mom, I know the problems women endure, from pregnancy to difficulty losing weight. With chiropractic care, we allow the body to heal itself with what is called adjustments. Journey Family Chiropractic can help you reach your full potential, so book your appointment today. You can get 50% off your first visit. Call 678-333-7919 or visit our website at www.journeyfamilychiro.com.
Today we have bear witness to a great poetry teller. She has performed her poetry all over the Metro Atlanta area. She has blessed us with her thoughts pertaining to love and the pitfalls of teenage pregnancy. And she is a published author with her book, Poetic Transitions, Evidence of Growth. Kelita A, the poetry teller, is a testament to what the words of power can do when you manifest them in the right way. Kelita, can you tell the people where you can be reached for booking?
People can reach me for booking on my website. It's www.skelita.com. So that's A-S-K-E-L-I-T-A.com. I'm also available on Facebook at Kelita A, the Poetry Teller, and on Twitter at follow_thelita, L-I-T-A.
Kelita, we here at L.E.A.D Media LLC, L.E.A.D TV, and the Poetry Corner. Thank you for speaking with us. We look forward to your progress in the future and being a part of it.
Thank you.
Family, we hope that you have enjoyed this episode. It's our first episode of the Poetry Corner. Kelita A, the poetry teller, has truly blessed us with her words. We look forward to this experience of the Poetry Corner with you all. So tell a friend, and tell that friend to tell a friend about the Poetry Corner, and to subscribe to L.E.A.D TV on YouTube. I am Jabe. Follow me on Instagram at JAABEY_3rd eye, and follow L.E.A.D Media LLC on Instagram at L.E.A.D Media Company. We will see you all next week as we are episode 2 of the Poetry Corner, featuring the lovely poet, Laisha. We leave you all in love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice. Peace, family.